actually brings us back, and I'm watching myself in the rough cut with all of this evidence, and I'm delighted because he's, you know, we're talking about molten metal. We're talking about nanothermite chips found in the dust, very high-tech stuff, not made in a cave in Afghanistan. I think your next hour's guest, Stephen Jones, will be talking in detail about that. But I told him about the small, previously molten iron spheres the size of a human hair that are found in all the dust samples, ignited thermite by chemical analysis. Anyway, all of this was in there, and we're delighted, right? And then he brings out these experiments that he's done. Emmertech, who's really nothing more than a defense contractor at New Mexico, because they're like Lawrence Livermore Lab or something. All of their money comes from defense.
They're on the government payroll.
That's for sure. And so they had these three experiments. They never talked to us, said what experiments they might be doing, what they didn't get our input at all. It's just, we're just watching these experiments.
So they lure you back to see the rough cut, and it's these experiments.
Well, yeah, then we see the rough cut, and we're delighted with what we were shown of ourselves, and then these experiments come on, and we're going, what the heck is this? Because we're looking at...
And by the way, they're videotaping your response. They're like, come see the rough cut. Now come in here. We want to show you some other clips. I mean, is that how this happened, and then really they're videotaping you?
Yes, and the intent was not that they were going to use our responses in the final version. The intent was that... What did he say? We just want a record that you're happy with what you saw, basically. So this is a manipulation, clearly. And I have to tell you, this thermite experiment, for instance, where they, excuse me, the beam where they put this 8-inch tall I-beam across 500 gallons of jet fuel and light it and put a 3,000-pound load in the middle of this I-beam, and we have in a couple of minutes temperatures rising very high and causing the failure of this beam. Well, first of all, had they talked to us, and even if they didn't talk to us, they should have known that NIST, in their investigation, hired Underwriter Laboratories to develop an exact replica of the floor truss system with this composite deck of concrete and metal decking. And they had under laboratory conditions, ASTM E119 is the test number. They put 2,000 degrees of fire under the truss and twice the known amount of loading on top of the floor system. And
stay there. This is scientific. I don't want to interrupt this. Yes, the underwriting laboratories found it wouldn't happen. But see, one of their members goes public, releasing their report. They fire him. That's Kevin Ryan. Stay there. We're going to come right back with architect and engineer Richard Gage. Just a powerful information. Stay with us.
Do you understand how dark it is? How far down the line we are? How late it is?
With sword and pistol by my side, many a young maid lost her baubles to my trade. Many a soldier shed his lifeblood on my blade. The bastards hung me in the spring of 25, but I am still alive.
Okay, Richard Gage, architects and engineers for 9/11 Truth founder. We got broken up by a couple breaks there. Recap what happened with the production company, with the television piece that just aired last week on the National Geographic channel, and then conclude in summary exactly what you're saying here, and then I have the question to ask after you're done.
Okay. So we have NIST hiring Underwriter Laboratories to create this mock section, and they tested it according to very scientific, well, time-honored tests. And it did not fail. They had three different versions of this thing. It sagged only 3 inches. It did not fail. NIST, of course, in turn, threw that test out and claims a 42-inch sag, by the way, to justify their column failure theory, which they needed in order to get Larry Silverstein his $5.68 billion. But the point is that instead of doing something scientific like this, we have National Geographic, Robert Erickson of Creative Differences, hiring Emmertech, a defense contractor, to show everybody, theoretically, how this building obviously fell apart. Well, first of all, they don't have 8-inch I-beams in the building. They have floor trusses, which certainly doesn't relate to any of the massive core columns in the building. We didn't have 500 gallons of jet fuel sitting there underneath anything. 90% of that jet fuel was expelled and exploded outside the building. The rest burned up, according to the official story, in just 10 minutes. So all the jet fuel did was ignite a normal office fire, whose temperatures don't get to be above 12 or 1,400 degrees. And even then, there's no evidence for temperatures over 5 or 600 degrees in the towers. So this whole thing from start to finish is just ludicrous. And this, by the way, this I-beam is not interconnected with several other beams, like in a normal office building where the heat is conducted away from the heat source throughout the columns and beams in the building, which is really the reason why we never have had a steel frame high-rise building collapse due to fire, because of this incredible conduction ability and interconnectedness. It's a huge heat sink. So this experiment and the other ones were set up to fail and manipulate the American people into thinking that this was science versus obviously these architects and engineers who are simply conspiracy theorists. But last night at the Commonwealth Club, we carefully laid out all this evidence, and he said, okay, at the end, which side is conspiracy and which side is science? So we have a show of hands. Guess what? 90% of the 60 people who were either believers of the official theory beforehand or who were unsure, 90% of those 60 people were convinced of the evidence for explosive
control. Okay, to be clear, you've got 200 people at this meeting. I guess you asked before who believes the official story, who doesn't. You're saying that's how you know it was 60 people?
That's right.
Okay, so they raise their hands, 60 saying, I believe the official story that 19 guys coordinated from caves in Afghanistan did this. Okay, great. And then at the end of it, you're saying 90% of those 60 people now believe the engineering, now believed your information.
Yes, and the numbers are 20 and 40, so that there's 20 people believing the official story before, 40 who were unsure, but 90% of those totaling 60 believed in the explosive controlled demolition theory afterward. And it's like that at every presentation, Alex. 90%.
And you get most of these presentations, correct me if I'm wrong, to architects and engineer groups.
Well, I not mostly. No, we do visit local architecture and engineering groups, and generally,
well, that's
we get
what I
all
meant.
Of,
you said you've made a whole mission out of. Yeah. I mean, how many architects and engineer groups have you talked to?
There's been about a dozen now.
Okay, well, what happens when you go to those?
Oh, it's fascinating because you get people who, first of all, most of them know nothing about the third worst structural failure in modern history. Building 7, 47-story skyscraper collapses to its own footprint in 6.5 seconds, and their jaws drop.
And by the way, NIST had always said free fall didn't happen, but then they were forced now to go ahead and say, okay, there was free fall involved. And they've given 5, 6 different stories and had to recant their previous reasons that Building 7 collapsed in their own NIST reports. I'd like you to speak to that. And even National Geographic, on the eve of this newest hit piece, said, oh, our last reasons for the towers collapsing with Pancake, we were wrong about that, but now we've got a new idea. So they're the one, because they say in the piece their story's never changed, the government story's never changed. But in truth, their story continually changes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's always changing. In fact, they wouldn't have changed if it weren't for members of AE911 Truth, David Chandler, a physicist, and Stephen Jones calling them publicly on their press conference, and they were forced into a corner. Now they have to admit that the 100 feet of this building, its drop, was in free fall. That's crushing 40,000 tons of structural steel at the same rate that a brick is falling off the building. It can't happen. And everybody knows that. And every architect and engineer we talk to knows that. So they end up signing our petition saying, yeah, let's get a real investigation.
I want to go back for a moment, and we'll continue going over this, you know, debunking them. The maker of the television show, who I've talked to on the phone, he's always trying to get me involved in these shows, or several shows, a JFK and a 9/11. And I tell this production company, no, I know you're deceptive. You're known as the most manipulative out there, that this is your specialty. And the guy laughs. I'm your friend. No, I want to show your side. And the JFK thing comes out, and it's a total fraud, the most skewed to the official story I've ever seen. And so that's why when I was warning you, I was saying, Richard, this is, you know, months ago, when you were doing the interviews, I said, this is not a friendly piece. You said, no, he's listening. He says it's going to be in there. He promises. Have you talked to him, which you now say that he lied to you? The question here is, are you going to put a public statement out on him? Are you going to, have you called him? Have you talked to him?